I welcome you to the Asian launch seminar of the report and recommendations of the Commission on Global Health Risks Framework for the Future. First, may I invite now the Dean of Medicine, Professor Gabriel Leung, co-director of the WHO Collaborating Center for Infectious Disease, Epidemiology and Control, to give the welcoming address. Dean Leung, please.
Thank you very much, Terry. There are so many dignitaries here, I don't really know how to start addressing each and every one of them, but allow me to just address my friends and colleagues here in the front row. We, of course, have the Undersecretary for Food and Health, Professor Sophia Chan, our co-organizer, the chairman of the Bauhinia Foundation, Dr. Donald Lee, the president of the National University of Singapore, and one of our international oversight group member, Professor Tan Chor Chuan here, Dr. Victor Dao, who really needs no introduction. He is really the reason we are all here, because he's the president of the National Academy of Medicine, which really spearheaded this whole exercise. Of course, we have our own president of Hong Kong U, Professor Peter Matheson, and not least, our fearless leader on the commission, Mr. Peter Sands, who is no stranger to Hong Kong. He spent a considerable part of his banking career here. He was formerly chief exec of Standard Chartered Bank. But today's questions, of course, will not focus on the world economy or indeed the Standard Chartered stock price. So allow me to, just by way of introduction, welcome everybody to this particular event, which is the Asia-Pacific launch of the commission report. And this commission has got a really very exact title. It's called The Neglected Dimension of Global Security. Not just health security, not just even human security, but global security, period. And it is about, really, the world's response post-Ebola, but it extends beyond Ebola and talks about a new global framework of dealing with epidemics, pandemics, and the humanitarian crises that they entail. Now, let me bring you back to Hong Kong and Hong Kong U in particular. The history of infectious diseases and dealing with epidemics and pandemics really started life here in Hong Kong U. Let me just go back in history. The Faculty of Medicine, which I'm dean, started life really with one particular pandemic which still haunts us, and that is malaria. My predecessor, back to the very first founding dean of our medical school, even before the university was founded. The medical school is 25 years older than the university. The founding dean was Patrick Manson. Just his name, even if you know nothing about him, you would recognize, for those of you who are microbiologists or infectious disease people, or even medics, you would remember the bug Schistosoma mansoni. That's him. He actually was the tutor of Ronald Ross, who got a Nobel for working out the malaria cycle. That particular cycle, of course, involves the vector, a particular mosquito. Now we have come full circle. Everybody, I just actually landed this morning back from Washington, D.C., everybody's talking about another vector-borne disease, also having a mosquito vector, of course, that is Zika and Zika virus. I see the director of health here today and the controller of the Center for Health Protection, which, of course, promulgated Hong Kong's local response guidelines on Zika barely 2 days ago. Another important pandemic, so-called the third plague, took place literally 1 kilometer from here. For those of you who are first-time visitors to Hong Kong, or even if you are a frequent visitor to Hong Kong, you may wish to go to Blake Garden, which is really just down one long flight of stairs from the university. That's the epicenter of the third plague. And in fact, that is exactly the place where the plague bacterium was first isolated. Yersinia pestis, of course, isolated by Alexander Yersin from the Institut Pasteur, which of course has got a Pasteur pole in Hong Kong U and have had for the last decade. So back from 100, 120, 130 years ago, if you fast forward to 1968, Hong Kong has that very unfortunate association with that particular flu pandemic, the 1968 Hong Kong flu. It was not quite as deadly as 1918, but certainly it again highlighted Hong Kong's role in these worldwide pandemics. Then if you sort of go to slightly more recent history, the year that Hong Kong repatriated back to China, 1997, where we were the first to report 18 human cases of H5N1. If you think of today, we have just about a dozen new human cases of H5N6, which is essentially, if you listen to Professor Guan Yi and his findings, has essentially all but replaced in the poultry flocks H5N1. And now we're beginning to see the first dozen human cases, mostly clustered around southern China. How that will turn out, nobody knows, but we're still accumulating H5N6 cases as we are accumulating H7N9 cases, which clusters around the Yangtze River Delta region since 2013. 2009, the swine flu pandemic. I believe that Hong Kong was the only place that quarantined an entire hotel because of that particular epidemic for one whole week. And in fact, I even say so myself, having been intimately involved in that particular intervention. If you actually look at the timing, it's uncanny because from May 1st, 2009, when we first identified that case and started quarantining in the hotel, to the first locally transmitted community case, it took us 40 days. And of course, where does the term quarantine comes from? Comes from the Italian quarantino. It bought us 40 days and helped us deal with that particular worldwide pandemic. 2013, H7N9, which is still ongoing. And of course, Hong Kong being one of the transit stops of the MERS-CoV case, which ultimately seeded the South Korean outbreak. So we are, if anything, really in the right place to be launching this particular report on the global health risk framework. I said Victor is the reason we're all here because Victor, for all his work throughout his entire career in non-communicable disease and its genomics, its prevention, its treatment, and having had the distinction of being both the chair of medicine at Stanford and at Harvard, is now the president of the National Academy of Medicine in the US, will be conferred an honorary doctorate by Hong Kong U on Tuesday. So when I brought the idea up with Victor and I said, Victor, seeing that you are in Hong Kong anyway, and that we really should be doing an Asian launch of this particular report. What do you think of building around your visit to Hong Kong a particular event? He quickly said, of course, we must do that, and invited the president of NUS, Professor Tan Chor Chuan, who is on the international oversight group of this particular report. And Chor Chuan, amidst his very, very busy schedule, said, yes, I am in, and let's do it on Sunday, because I have to go back and take the red-eye flight. So this is real dedication. So Chor Chuan is going to take the red-eye flight back to Singapore tonight, this evening, for his morning engagement. So thank you so much for coming. And I know that you have a special affinity with Hong Kong U, because both you and Peter work on a particular part of our body, and that is the kidney. So I thought that I could use that to persuade you that you are really kindred spirits. We also, of course, must thank Dr. Donald Lee, who is chairman of the Bauhinia Foundation. Bauhinia is a local think tank and a very prominent local think tank. It pushes out weekly reports on hot policy topics of interest, and really works very, very hard to put relevant topics at the top of Hong Kong people's agenda, but also has a regional focus. So Donald, also being the president of the Hong Kong Academy of Medicine, has very, very kindly joined in to be co-host of this particular event. And in fact, the vice chairman of the Bauhinia Foundation, Mr. Lau Ming Wai, who will be joining us at 5 at the tea reception, because I think he's tied up with the Youth Commission, of which he's also chairman, actually was one of the anchor sponsors for this particular report and its work, and has paid a personal visit to Victor in Washington, D.C., and really has paid close personal interest to the deliberations and the findings of this commission. Today is truly a regional event, because I see many, many friends from Singapore, Malaysia, Indonesia, Philippines, and Thailand here. Of course, not to forget friends and colleagues from the mainland, notably one of the other key anchor sponsors of this particular report, the Gates Foundation. My good friend Alex Ng is here. He's the deputy of Gates China in Beijing, and I'm really thrilled to see him here today. And allow me to pay particular tribute and thanks to the Singaporean Minister of State for Health, Mr. Chee Hong Tat. Thank you very, very much for leading your delegation to Hong Kong. I know that you'll be visiting Dr. Constance Chan and her colleagues, as well as Professor Sophia Chan, Dr. Koh Wing Man, and their colleagues over the next few days in Hong Kong. And I see a huge Singaporean contingent here. This is wonderful. Welcome, and thank you for coming here. Of course, the Malaysian Deputy Director General of Health, Dr. Sulaiman, is also in the audience. So thank you so much for coming and gracing the event. There are just too many friends from India, Indonesia, Korea, Philippines, for me to name individually, but a collective welcome to all of you. Finally, our stalwart partners in the local health policy scene, I see key supporters from government: Professor Sophia Chan, our Undersecretary; Dr. Constance Chan, our Director of Health; Deputy Director of Health, Dr. Cindy Lai; the Controller of the Center for Health Protection, Dr. T.H. Leung. Of course, from the Central Policy Unit, Mrs. Sophie Kao, thank you so much all for your support and for coming to hear what the panel has to say, because it is of critical import, not only to Hong Kong and China, but also regionally and globally. I told you that I just came back from Washington, D.C., so allow me to quote from one of the real giants and icons in infectious diseases from the National Institutes of Health, Tony Fauci. Tony Fauci wrote, actually, about a decade ago, and I thought that it's a wonderful quote, so I always use it. He said, "If history is our guide, we can assume that the battle between the intellect and will of the human species and the extraordinary adaptability of microbes will be never-ending. And that is why we are here today, and hopefully, with this new global health risk framework, we shall be able to mitigate some of the catastrophic humanitarian crises and adverse impact given us by nature and nature's microbes. So with that, allow me to now pass the time to the real substance and content of today's meeting. So thank you very much indeed, and enjoy the afternoon.
Thank you, Dean Leong. Our first speaker is Professor Tan Chor Chuan, a member of the International Oversight Group of the Commission and the President of the National University of Singapore. May I now invite Professor Tan to present the keynote address on outbreak preparedness and response, enduring lessons from SARS. Professor Tan, please.
Distinguished guests, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. First, I want to thank Gabriel Victor and Hong Kong U for the pleasure and honor of being able to share some thoughts at the launch of the Commission's report. Now that my cover has been somewhat been blown, I do apologize, but also commend your commitment for spending your Sunday afternoon at this very important event. The topic I've chosen seems a little bit outdated, but I choose it because for many of the countries in this region, Hong Kong, Singapore, China, Taiwan, the SARS outbreak was the defining moment for all our health systems. And also, more than a decade has now passed since the SARS epidemic. We've had a lot of time to study the lessons and to take action. And as we will hear later on today, there are many lessons which have been enduring, but many actions which have yet to be taken fully in addressing the threat of epidemic outbreaks. This slide summarizes the 2003 Singapore SARS epidemic. It is a complicated slide, but I just wanted to point out three things. The first, at the bottom, you'll see we had 206 clinically diagnosed cases. The second point is that a lot of the action took place in health facilities, hospitals, nursing homes. There were just two relatively small community involvements. The social cluster, group cluster, is a polite way of referring to a staff of one of the hospitals who, before he was quarantined, went to play mahjong and then infected the rest of his mahjong crowd. So by right, that should be the mahjong cluster. And the third point I want to raise is that while it seemed like a very long time, the outbreak in Singapore lasted 3 months. But for much of the first half of that period, we did not know the cause of the outbreak, the infectious agent, and of course, there was no diagnostic kit, and this posed very particular problems. Because of that, strategies had to be adapted very rapidly as we gained knowledge of the infectious agent and the mode of transmission, and we learned three important things in a short space of time. The first was that the real battleground, at least in Singapore, was a hospital, and in fact, hospitals amplified the epidemic. 78% of our cases were acquired in hospitals. The second was that while SARS by itself was not really very infectious, a small number of people were highly infectious, and they played a very critical role in propagating outbreaks. So this is the experience in Singapore where just 5 patients actually accounted for infection in more than half the number of cases that we had. And the third was SARS being a novel infection. It was characterized as a respiratory infection and typical pneumonia. But we soon learned, of course, that it could present in many different ways with diarrhea, and that, in fact, fever, chest X-ray changes may come very late in the course of the infection. And with no diagnostic kit at the beginning, this proved almost impossible to identify infectious people with SARS. So the adaptation of those strategies over of our strategies over time allowed us to apply sort of age-old methods of isolation and quarantine to control the outbreak. And here's just some data from Singapore showing weeks of the periods of infection. And right at the start of the outbreak, and see that it took roughly less than 7 days from the onset of symptoms to the time the patient was isolated to at the peak of the outbreak. It took about 3 days from onset to isolation, and about 40% of people were known to the health system and quarantined or under surveillance before they actually were expressed themselves as SARS infections. We, of course, learned many things from the SARS outbreak, but I'd like to just highlight five lessons which I think are particularly enduring and which I think resonate very well with the recommendations and the findings of the Commission's report, which you'll hear about in a great deal more detail later. The first really important lesson for us in Singapore was that we started out by dealing with this as a public health outbreak problem, and confined largely, the management is largely confined to the Ministry of Health and the health system. But we rapidly found out that, in fact, it was not a public health crisis alone, but a national crisis. And this is summarized by one of the newspaper cuttings. There are many, many of these newspaper reports. This one is from a Singapore newspaper in April, which says, "When hysteria rules, fear over SARS could be more damaging to the economy than the outbreak itself." And all of us who have lived through this understand exactly what this means. Shops are empty, people stopped going out, travel was very severely affected. And the countries which were worst affected by the SARS outbreak experienced significant negative economic impacts. If you take the case of Singapore, we had 206 cases, largely over a two-month period. So roughly 200 cases over 2 months. And the impact on our economy, we lost 1% of GDP growth. And a lot of this was concentrated in the hospitality and travel segment. And you see fairly similar effect on countries like China, Hong Kong on a quarterly basis, and an effect on a similar of a similar magnitude in Canada. So what that meant in Singapore really was the realization that this was a national crisis as opposed to a public health crisis meant that the whole response had to be elevated to a national level. And in fact, at the start of the outbreak, when WHO first declared it as a global pandemic, the Ministry of Health set up a SARS task force. But very soon after, 3 weeks later, a ministerial committee was formally created in order to lead and coordinate the response. Now, this is a very busy slide, but it just illustrates one key point, which is there are many levels of coordination required, the top of which involved five ministers who were involved with taking decisions on what major initiatives would proceed, the control measures that would be put in place. Then there was an executive group with many, many civil servants and permanent secretaries, almost the entire cast of permanent secretaries were involved. Then the Ministry of Health had its task force, which was involved with development strategies and also the implementation in the health system. And then there were inter-ministry SARS operations committees of various forms. So a much more elaborate national decision-making structure and coordinating apparatus was set up. The second big lesson that we learned was that stringent infection control is really vital in healthcare facilities. And if you look at this rather complicated chart, you'll see that when WHO made its announcement and its global alert on the 13th of March, what we could see, which is the tip of the iceberg, we saw 18 patients with fever who were later diagnosed to have SARS, but they were in different wards in the hospital, and it was not really easy, even retrospectively, to join all the dots, to be able to say, could we have detected all these cases earlier, seen a pattern which would have allowed us to recognize that we're dealing with an outbreak? It was really not possible, particularly as there's no diagnostic kit. And at the submerged side of the iceberg while we saw 18 cases, in fact, the patients who were infected were coming into contact with large numbers of people. And in the end, during that period, 68 people, unbeknownst to us, were already infected, who were going to manifest later. So the point I'm making here is that we can have heightened surveillance, but it's not going to be able to pick up every type of outbreak as it's emerging. And the best way for us to try to mitigate the impact of outbreak size, outbreaks growing very quickly, is to have very stringent infection controls. If you could mitigate some of these contacts and transmission of infectious diseases, even as you're trying to figure out whether you're dealing with an outbreak, then you would have a chance of having a much smaller size outbreak by the time you detect it. The other very important factor involved is that, of course, the fear was not just in the amongst the public. The fear also was very much amongst the medical and healthcare professionals. They were afraid that they were going to get infected, that they will bring this back to their families, that they may lose their lives. And one of the things that we did was to designate the first hospital to be affected by the outbreak, Tan Tock Seng Hospital, as a SARS hospital. And the leadership there instituted very stringent adoption of personal protective equipment and infection control. And once they did that, we were able to show that no other healthcare worker got infected. And we were able then to tell everybody in the health system that if you adopted a similarly stringent regime, you too will be protected. Now, the background to this, of course, was a lot of information going on the internet that you needed to wear space suits, you needed two masks, two gloves, two sets of PPE, and yet you will not be protected. So we need also to be able to demonstrate with data that our healthcare worker colleagues will be protected if they took the appropriate measures to do so. The third very important lesson to be learned was that epidemic readiness requires really extensive and difficult work. In Singapore, before the crisis, the SARS outbreak, we thought we were pretty well prepared. But when the test came, our preparation was just not good enough. It requires us building expertise, developing new systems, structures, having detailed plans, training and audit in a whole number of areas, ranging from surveillance and joining the dots, understanding when an outbreak might be happening. In the hospitals, not just stringent hospital control, infection control, not just new procedures, but also physical changes to the ward layout, increasing our lab diagnostic capacity, having proper national command and coordination structures, and then also ensuring that we had the means to implement decisions that were made, stockpiles of protective equipment, vaccines, and so on, and as well as public communications plans. So a large number of things needed to be done, and it took us actually several months in order to strengthen our own preparedness capacity. So if you transpose this onto systems which are less well-resourced, which are at less mature states of development as Singapore or Hong Kong, then the problems are severely compounded, as we saw in outbreaks such as Ebola in West Africa. I think what came home to us in Singapore too, towards the tail end of the outbreak, was of course we realized that being prepared within Singapore was really important, but it's really not good enough. In the sense that there were no ways in which you could build walls and isolate yourself from infectious disease threats from around the world. And so we don't just need to have local preparedness, you also needed global preparedness. And the reasons for this are very straightforward, and I think all of us understand this. The first is, of course, that viruses and epidemics can travel very easily by aeroplanes. And during the Singapore outbreak, we had an incident that really underscored this for Singapore and really for the world. We had an infectious disease specialist who had attended to some patients in Singapore, went for an infectious disease conference in New York, got atypical pneumonia there, was seen by a doctor, cleared to fly, and was flying back to Singapore via Frankfurt. And before he flew, he called his friends in Singapore and told them what happened. their friends notified us in the ministry, and we said, well, we better let the Germans know. We called the people in Frankfurt. So when the plane touched down, it was brought to a special place. People in spacesuits got onto the aeroplane and took everybody away to a high containment facility. And I think that really dramatic sequence of events really underscored something which all of us kind of suspected already, that viruses can fly on aeroplanes, and that is a potent way by which epidemics can spread. And later on, of course, this was validated as we worked out the sequence of events that related to the origins of the SARS epidemic in our region. Of course, it had been brewing for some time in southern China in November of 2003. A physician went in late February 2003, stayed in a hotel in Hong Kong, infected 12 other Hong Kong guests in that hotel, and they flew to different parts of the world and triggered off the first wave of infections in Vietnam, Singapore, Hong Kong, Canada, and later on, of course, from there to China and to Taiwan. So this one person infected 12 people, and eventually by 6 weeks later, we had 250 cases of SARS, which were traced back to this one event. Now, this was in 2003. Today, of course, the problem is severely compounded because air travel has expanded. If you look at the 2009 H1N1 pandemic, it was first started in Mexico in February or March, was declared a national emergency by Mexico in mid-March. And during that period alone, 300,000 people flew out from Mexico every week to different parts of the world. And in May of 2009, nearly 1.3 million people flew out of Mexico, going to places like the US, Canada, and Europe. So today, with budget travel, with massive numbers of people on the move, no part of the world is remote anymore. Infection in one part of the world can very easily find itself in other parts of the world. So what this means, of course, is that we are as well-prepared as the least prepared part of the global community. And in countries which are less well-prepared, outbreaks that occur there can very rapidly pose a significant threat to the entire global community. What is very striking, of course, is that even then, in 2009, when a commission was set up to review the functioning of the international health regulations of 2005, which had been significantly strengthened in the wake of the SARS epidemic, it found that commission in 2009 found that many countries were not able to put in place or had not put in place the capabilities, the preparedness that were required under the international health regulations. And I think this will be a point that will be revisited by the panel later on. So it really underscores the fact that we can't just try to have local preparedness. We must have effective surveillance, information sharing, and analysis at a global level, and that we have to have very strongly coordinated global capabilities to prevent, to survey, to prepare, and to respond to outbreaks in different parts of the world. And the final thing that we learned in Singapore was the critical element of trust. When the outbreak first started, there was a great deal of fear. People feared that nurses would spread infections to the community, so they shunned the nurses. When we had home quarantine orders, people were very afraid that this meant that that whole neighborhood might be affected, and therefore people on home quarantine orders were shunned. But I must say that one of the lessons for myself personally was the way in which the political leaders and the community leaders in Singapore managed to rally support and converted a lot of this community anxiety into positive energy, through communications, through reassurance, through active action. And what we found was tremendous reversal of this, very strong support for healthcare workers, which in turn enabled them to do a much better job. And we feared that nobody would ever sign up to do a nursing course after that, But in fact, after the SARS epidemic, the applications to our nursing school went up quite significantly. So this was a very positive thing. And a key to that really was good communications, timely, credible, honest, and addressing what different groups were most concerned about. Of course, this all occurred in the pre-social media days, and all of us know that effective, rapid communications is even more challenging today than in that period. So I'm once again very happy and honored to be able to share some lessons, enduring lessons from the 2003 SARS outbreak, talking to a very distinguished and knowledgeable audience here. Many of the things I've said are not new, but I thought that they were worth reiterating, given the backdrop, as a backdrop to the recommendations we'll hear, that SARS was not just a public health crisis, but a national crisis, that stringent infection control in healthcare facilities is really critical, that it needs a great deal of extensive hard work and resources to be really prepared for an epidemic, that even as we do that, being prepared locally is very important, but it's not good enough. You also need global preparedness across the planet, and that it's not just medical interventions, coordination, logistics, but we also have to deal with this element of trust. People need to trust health authorities, ministries of health, communities, community leaders, and that if we are able to do all these together, then we'll be in a better position to try to prevent or at least mitigate the impact of the next epidemic, which will surely come. So with that, thanks very much indeed, and I'm looking forward to the further panel discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Tan. Our next presenter is Professor Victor Tao, who is the president of the U.S. National Academy of Medicine. Professor Tao also chairs the International Oversight Group of the Commission, and he's going to tell us more about the background of the Commission. Professor Tao, please.
Thank you, Professor Khan, and first, President Peter Matheson, President Chuan Tang, and of course, President Emeritus Lep Chi Choy, who's here with us today, but also all the leaders from Hong Kong and international distinguished leaders and guests. What a privilege it is for us, the National Academy in US, to launch this report in Asia, in Hong Kong. For me, there are many great reasons that we should be here. Not least of which is I was born, pardon me, I grew up in Hong Kong. That being said, I'm just very pleased to tell you about this particular report, which is called Neglected Dimension of Global Security. Now, the purpose of doing this was creating, really to make a recommendation to create a global health risk framework for the future pandemics in terms of emergency responsiveness as well as preparedness. And our work originated, of course, from the Ebola outbreak, which, as many of you know, had a devastating effect in West Africa. So for the past 2 years, the world has witnessed the deadliest outbreak in Ebola has ever seen, and destroyed lives and families and ripped the socioeconomic fabric of Guinea, Liberia, and Sierra Leone, and beyond. In this slide, I show you some of the socioeconomic impact, of course, health impact. As you can see, as of February, the end of February, there's about 28,000, over 28,000 cases, which 11,300 deaths. You're gonna hear a lot about the importance of the health aspects, and of course, we're all here because lives are important. But also the economic impact has been pointed out by both Gabriel and Chechuan is also significant. Even over a year ago, the World Bank estimated a 2.2 billion loss, in fact, in those three countries and much more beyond. And I think the number is increasing. Now, the question is what went wrong? And you know, when you look at every step of the response from a surveillance system to alert system to a response, they were clearly inadequate. There are problems at all levels, international community to countries to local communities. For example, international level, the response was slow and uncoordinated. At the country level, there's a failure of traditional surveillance, lack of resources, of course, and weak public health and healthcare systems. And as has been mentioned by Chichuan, at the community level, there's a lack of trust. There was certainly a lack of a breakdown in communication and information about disease, particularly in rural areas. Now, it's good to know that 2 years later, we're now beginning to get out from under this particular emergency. But that being said, as Ebola pandemic is waning, Zika virus is now emerging as the next new threat to global health. Now, just a word on Zika, because it's all relevant from what you've heard from all different pandemics and infectious outbreak. Zika in Americas, now Zika virus was actually first described in 1947, but in Americas was first confirmed in February 2014 in, on Easter Island in Chile. And then it spread on since then, last 2 years, first to Brazil, of course, and Brazil in 2014 recognized a cluster of febrile illness with rash. And of course, was confirmed in April 2015. And by October 2015, a single state in the northeast of Brazil, Bahia, reported 56,000 cases already. By now, the Brazilian national authorities estimate about 500,000 to 1.5 million cases of Zika. And of course, the number's increasing. It's also been demonstrated now that the transmission has been reported in 31 different countries in this region, and of course, many others because of the mosquito vector Aedes aegypti. Now, the biggest concern, as you know, of a Zika virus spread is the effect on pregnant women and newborn, particularly microcephaly, but also a surge of neurological immune illnesses such as Guillain-Barré and other disorders. So the question really we face ourselves is what's happening in this world? If you look at this slide, actually a diagram in the New England Journal of Medicine article, which I think you have in your handout, that Peter Sands and I wrote, look at the last, say, 13 years in terms of infectious disease outbreaks, epidemics, and pandemics. I think it would be very obvious to you that we have emerging and re-emerging infectious disease. And importantly, particularly the last several years, towards the end of this 13 years, we have a large number and increased frequency of pandemics and outbreaks. I think this increase in frequency is probably primarily due to, as you know, urbanization, the crowded living, but also change in the environment, climate change, and many others. And also, of course, the close proximity of animals to humans, the transmission of zoonotic diseases, and of course, globalization, as you heard from Dr. Chichuan Tang. So really what we need is a global health risk framework. In addition to the local response, we need a framework that can emerge, can mobilize rapid responses, and of course, and over time, create a framework that can be prepared globally for such. And so in fact, this slide summarizes the need to go forward with a framework. Now, let me say a word about who we are at National Academy of Medicine. We were the health arm of the National Academy of Sciences, which is founded, in fact, chartered by Abraham Lincoln in Congress in 1863. 45 years ago, the Institute of Medicine was founded as the health arm, and of course, just about 7-8 months ago, we reconstituted as the National Academy of Medicine. We've done a lot of this kind of work globally and internationally in terms of looking at recommendations to significant health problems. And of course, on this particular one, I want to focus on what it is, this framework, and what is this work that we did, and quickly turn over to Peter Sands, the chair of the commission, to discuss this. Well, needless to say, we all recognize there's a need for this. But when I had breakfast with Jim Kim in the fall of 2014, we thought we should actually jump in and begin to look at a report that can help the globe to be better prepared. Shortly, we have support from Judith Roden, And then, of course, Margaret Chan and Jim Kim hosted a meeting for us in December. And in March 2015, we began planning for this homework, for this framework. I want to first recognize that this work is supported by seven foundations, a private donor, and USAID. And particularly, as you can see here, from Paul Allen Foundation, Ford's Foundation, Moore Foundation, Rockefeller Foundation, Wellcome Trust, of course, a shout out to Alex Ng, thank you very much, from the Rockefeller, from the Gates Foundation, the Deputy Director of Gates Foundation Asia, but also, of course, Donald Lee, who's hosting this today, with the Bauhinia Foundation, of course, Wai Ming Lau, who's been a supporter of this initiative. Now, the framework, the architecture goes something like this. We have a commission of 17 commissioners from 12 different countries. It's an international commission with five different continents that includes clinicians, scientists, social researchers, policy, industry leaders, financiers, and community leaders. Four commissioners come from the West African countries which are affected. We have an international, as shown here in the roster, and of course, importantly, a shout out to Gabriel Leung, who plays a very important role, as is others, in this commission. The International Oversight Group was chaired by myself and Judith Roden, as you heard from Chichuan Tang, who's part of our oversight group and others. And the Oversight Group set up the commission with the idea of guidance on the slate of commissioners, approve the process, look at guidelines for report review, and assist with dissemination strategy. Importantly, the commission was informed by four work streams, as you see in this slide, one on the health international governance, one on financing of pandemics, health system strengthening, and of course, R&D, which is also a very important part of the response and preparedness of pandemics. I'm not going to go through this. Suffice to say that the number of people involved were about 250 experts were consulted for different fields, 11 days of public hearing in Washington, Hong Kong, London, and Ghana and Accra through these workshops and multiple consultations, with the commission eventually releasing a report just about a little bit over a month ago in New York at Rockefeller Foundation. I say that we're very proud of this report because it has these four important elements. Independence. This is not a report commissioned by WHO or UN for that matter, which obviously would be more political. We see this as one independent from international agencies, stakeholders, or other governments. Forward-looking. This is not just one on Ebola. We, of course, look at previous outbreaks from SARS, MERS, H1N1, and AIDS pandemics to look at what our lessons learned, and comprehensiveness, an effective framework ranging from models of governance to, in fact, infrastructure locally, as well as scientific R&D and others, as you hear, and financing, and timeliness, with this in a record speed in 6 months, and was launched, in fact, as you heard, in January. I think the key issue for us is dissemination. This report is now has received the attention of many, many leaders in this area, not only health leaders, but world leaders. For example, we were, in fact, had the chance to present this at the World Economic Forum in Davos, at the WHO Executive Board meeting that Peter and I presented to, but importantly, at the G7 summit meeting, and not only December, but I just was in the G7 planning group in Japan last month, and this will be on the agenda. On the Peter went to World Bank, WHO, USAID preparedness and financing. We're launching here in Asia. We've been launching in Africa. And importantly, in April, the World Bank and IMF spring meetings. So I just want to say a word about how important this is and what a great leadership Peter has exhibited, the chair of a commission. You hear 26 recommendations which are coordinated and really looking at delivering a specific time frame. So I hope that you get a chance to hear the recommendations. Larry Gosten, who is also a member of the commission, is here. Peter Sands, the chair, and Gabriel Leung. So with this, let me then introduce Peter Sands, who is the chair of the commission. Peter is a senior fellow at the Mostafa Rahmani Center for Business and Government at Harvard Kennedy School. He's also the lead non-executive director of the board of United Kingdom's Department of Health. Prior to this, he was the group's chief executive of Standard Chartered Bank. And Peter, who's a world-class financier and banker, has learned public health extremely fast. I would say he's one of those guys who, in fact, is a quick learner. And he's led this commission extremely ably. And let me ask Peter to come up and tell us about the recommendations. Peter?
Thank you, Victor, for those very generous words. Gabriel described me as a fearless leader as chairman. I had to be somewhat fearless because chairing a commission on which every other member has forgotten more about the topic than you are ever going to learn is quite a daunting prospect. May I also thank Peter for hosting us here and all our distinguished guests for joining us here this afternoon. Many of you will no doubt have read the report, or at least the New England Journal of Medicine article in which we gave a perspective on the report, so you will be relieved to hear that I am not going to go through all 26 recommendations in detail. There are 200 pages or so of the report if you want that level of detail. But what I wanted to do is highlight some of the more important, and perhaps most importantly, show how they fit together. This is not a laundry list of recommendations, but it's a coherent, cohesive set that work together. And we have been constantly emphasizing this to policymakers because what we don't want to have happen is that they pick the easy ones to do and park the more difficult ones, because frankly, it doesn't work like that. You don't get the impact unless you do all of it. So what I'm going to do, that's not very helpful. Right, is quickly give you an overview of the report recommendations, then talk a bit about how this works together as a framework for global health risk mitigation, and then give you some quick concluding remarks. The 26 recommendations that the Commission came up with fall into four groups. First of all, we had some overarching recommendations. First and foremost, that we had to have action, that just having a set of recommendations on a nicely printed report or even some agreements at international meetings wasn't going to be good enough. As Professor Tan Chiu-Tran said, there have been enduring lessons from others. Unfortunately, patchy implementation of these lessons has also been enduring. We have been very slow to implement the lessons from previous epidemics and pandemics. The second thing is we wanted the money. One of the sad things about initiatives in the public health arena is people are quicker to agree to do something than they are to agree to open their wallets to pay for that same something. And then they're rather disappointed when not a lot happens. We came up with a figure of about $4.5 billion a year. That may be too little. On the other hand, $4.5 billion would make a huge difference to addressing some of the weak links that the professor talked about. Now, $4.5 billion we've been challenged on as how realistic is that? Are people going to come up with the money? Well, to start with, it isn't all going to come from one place. We actually think that a lot of it ought to come from domestic resource mobilization, i.e. countries' own fiscal resources. Secondly, that $4.5 billion a year has to be seen in the context of how much does the threat of potential pandemics cost us. We did some modeling of various scenarios of the next 100 years, and averaging it out came up with a figure of roughly $60 billion a year as the expected economic loss. I'm not talking about lives and the impact on families and humans. I'm talking just about the economic loss, $60 billion a year. So far, most of the criticism we've had on this number has been that it's too small. And we knew it was on the conservative end of the spectrum. But even if you accept $60 billion a year, spending an incremental $4.5 billion a year to significantly reduce the risks of that impact seems like a pretty good investment case. Finally, we also thought it was really important to lock in now monitoring of implementation. It's very easy with these sorts of global initiatives to commit to big things and make proclamations. It's much harder to hold yourself accountable 1 year or 3 years down the road as to whether or not you have actually done the things that you said you would do. The next 10 recommendations all related to public health systems at a national level. We saw this as the core foundation of a national health system and the first line of defense. While there has been a lot of attention on how the WHO works, and that's really important, the reality is if the local level systems, and I think Professor's example showed this, if they don't work, there is very little that's going to happen at an international level that can compensate for those weaknesses. I'm not going to go into detail around all 10 of these recommendations, but a few things I want to highlight. One is that it's really important to have a very clear definition of what we mean by the core capabilities that constitute a resilient public health system that can prevent, detect, and mount a response to infectious disease outbreaks. We have components of that in various codes, the IHR, the Global Health Security Agenda, the Terrestrial Animal Health Code, but we need to bring those together and have a single defined set of capabilities. And then, even more important, we need objective, independent assessment of national performance against those benchmarks. At the moment, what we have is self-assessment against rather high-level IHR, International Health Regulation, benchmarks. Even on that basis, more than 60% of the countries in the world reckon they don't meet those benchmarks. Now, that's flattering, frankly, because some of that self-assessment is pretty complimentary. And also, as I say, they're rather high level. So we know we have some pretty significant gaps, some weak links. Third, we need plans at a country level to address those gaps, and we need the financial resources deployed to ensure that that actually happens. As I mentioned, we think that for many countries, certainly the advanced economies and middle-income economies, the primary reliance should be on domestic resource mobilization. Why is this important? Well, this is not like building a bridge or building a dam. This is something that you need to spend this year, next year, every year, thereafter. So it needs to be a sustainable source of financing, and the best way of having sustainable sources of financing is to do it from domestic resources. It is also the case that that builds ownership, local political and leadership and ownership. Obviously, poorer countries, fragile and frail states, will need financial support from the international community. But certainly, wherever possible, we should be thinking about how that tapers off and is replaced by domestic resource mobilization. One other point worth highlighting is that we thought it important that the IMF and indeed the World Bank include the quality of pandemic preparedness in their assessments of economic risk vulnerability and economic policy effectiveness. This is for two reasons. One, because it is a real economic risk, and we are seeing this once again being demonstrated with Zika. And two, because it's a good way of focusing finance ministers' attention on the topic if they suddenly find that the weaknesses in their public health system turn up in their IMF risk assessments. So Local, national, public health systems are the first line of defense, but they need also, sorry about that, to be complemented by a stronger global and regional system for outbreak preparedness, alert, and response. And here we had another 10 recommendations. And again, I won't go into all of them. The first few of them all relate to the WHO. And the WHO has already made significant changes in its ability to prepare and respond and to lead the coordinated response to international outbreaks. It needs a dedicated center, but it also needs the money to support that dedicated center. And it needs contingency resources. It needs the flexibility and the capability that it clearly didn't have and didn't demonstrate at the time of Ebola. It also needs better coordination mechanisms with the rest of the UN system and with non-state actors, NGOs, the private sector, and so on. We also argued for a more graduated system of alerts. At the moment, it's somewhat binary. You either have no alert or you have a public health emergency of international concern. And then finally, we discussed the role that the IMF and the World Bank could play in providing financial support to countries and regions afflicted by outbreaks. Sorry. Our final three recommendations were all about research. What we are constantly discovering with infectious disease outbreaks is that we're on the back foot. We're scrambling to develop diagnostic tools. We don't have the right vaccines. We even don't have the right kind of protective equipment or lab gear. And we need to get more on the front foot because time is of the essence in these situations. And so we argued that we needed more money devoted to it, and we put forward a figure of $1 billion a year as being the kind of figure one needed to be thinking about if you were going to make a meaningful difference to the level of scientific preparedness. Secondly, it needed to be better coordinated. And so we had this concept of an independent pandemic product development committee, which would be galvanized, catalyzed by the WHO, but independent, to ensure that there was greater discussion of where the priorities and how efforts could be coordinated. And then finally, we argued that one of the problems is that even when we have product that could be potentially useful, the plethora of overlapping regulatory approval processes and different clinical protocols and things tends to slow down how quickly we can get this stuff into the field. And so there are actions to be taken across those arena. So what does this add up to? It adds up to stronger national public health capabilities and infrastructure and processes with a common standard and regularly assessed through an objective, transparent process. Secondly, more effective global and regional capabilities with a re-energized WHO with dedicated response and resources, coordinated more effectively with the rest of the UN system. And thirdly, an accelerated program of R&D. We entitled our report, as Gabriel Lung said, The Neglected Dimension of Global Security. And indeed, as someone new to the field of infectious disease outbreaks, I find it quite remarkable how little we had devoted in terms of policy attention and resources to the threats of such scale. These are a very significant threat to both human lives and economic well-being. There is a compelling case for investing more. As I say, $4.5 billion, we could probably spend more than that, but that would make a significant difference to the risks to human lives. And one lesson that I think is constantly learned from every infectious disease outbreak is that investing in preparedness has a far better payoff than sitting back and waiting for something bad to happen, which tends to be incredibly expensive. So our recommendations were devised as a framework, working together at both the first line of defense, the global and regional level, and the R&D. And then finally, this is not something that we can sort of sit and sort of ponder about. If we needed a reminder of this, as we published the report in January, of course, Zika was escalating on the global stage as being a really very, very real reminder of the constancy of this threat. Thank you very much. That was a quick overview, but I hope gave you a sense of the essence of the Commission's recommendations. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Our final speaker for the first part of this afternoon's proceedings is Professor Lawrence Gustin. Professor Gustin is also commissioner. He's university professor at Georgetown University. He's the faculty director of the O'Neill Institute for National Global Health Law, and finally, director of the WHO Collaborating Center on Public Health Law and Human Rights. You have his title in the program as Legal and Ethical Challenges in Shaping Effective Responses to Outbreaks, but he has decided to take as his topic a slightly different title, Global Governance for Health from WHO Reform to the UN System. Professor Gustin.
Thank you, and I wanted to reiterate my thanks that Peter, Victor, and others have said to our hosts. I will be talking about governance, and I will also be drilling down on some of the areas that Peter Sands talked about in his overview. You were promised something about ethics, so I thought I would begin with that. And then I'll look at really the two major pillars of global health preparedness. One is the foundation of a strong, resilient national health system and how we operate that in accordance with the rule of law and in accordance with the rule of international law through the international health regulations. And then I'm going to look at the international level, principally the role of the World Health Organization, but also the role of the wider United Nations system. And then I'm just going to make some concluding reflections about the high politics of global security, which I think that we're all very concerned about. First, a little bit about ethics. During Ebola, I was very active, and a lot of my close friends in the global health community, particularly in the AIDS community, said, why are we spending so much time talking about Ebola when every day more people die of AIDS, tuberculosis, and malaria than do throughout the entire Ebola outbreak? And there were many reasons for this, but to me, there was a deep moral dimension. And the moral dimension was that there was a highly preventable outbreak in three of the poorest, most fragile countries in the world. And the international community sat back, including the World Health Organization, delayed both in declaring a public health emergency of international concern and then delayed in terms of its mobilization of the necessary political will and financing. And it was unconscionable that we allowed that to occur, particularly with healthcare worker to patient ratios, which are the worst in the world, and yet we lost about 500 healthcare workers from the Ebola epidemic. But there was a very important moral and public health lesson from Ebola, which is that we really can work together as an international community if we decide to, because once we mobilized the response, we were able to bring an epidemic that was spinning out of control under control. So this is something that's not fanciful. What the Global Health Risk Framework Commission's ideas are, can and have worked and will work in the future. The other reflection I wanted to make on the moral dimension was Zika, because here we are now with another ongoing major epidemic that has swept through the Americas and the Caribbean, as Victor pointed out. To me, there is also this deep moral dimension of Zika. So imagine this. Imagine that you now have a large cluster of Zika cases, and then 9 months from now, there is a large cluster of congenital malformalities. And you then notice that the world didn't do enough, and yet all of these young women, particularly poor young women, are having babies with malformations. I think this will cause a public, political, moral outrage internationally, and will only spread as Zika spreads, as it will, from Latin America and the Caribbean through to many of the southern platitudes in the world, including South Asia, where we are now, the southern part of the United States, southern Europe, and of course, the major concern currently is Africa. So we've talked a little bit, or quite a lot, about, and our report does, about the public health and human dimensions of epidemics, and we've also talked about the economic dimensions. In my view, Peter's leadership really brought out that economic side that I think it had been too much neglected, and we showed the case for much, much greater investment in global health. But I wanted to begin just by emphasizing that there's also a deep moral dimension to pandemics that we must never forget. There are really two major building blocks to global health security. The first is the foundation, which are national health systems, and the other is the World Health Organization and the UN system at the apex, and trying to empower the WHO and the UN system to be everything that they were intended to be when the WHO was formed as the first specialized agency of the UN in 1948. National health systems are not only something that medicine and public health understand to be critical, but also they are part of national and international law. At the national level, many, many countries around the world have the right to health in their constitution. The international health regulations has been one of the most widely ratified treaties in the world, with 196 states parties. And the international health regulations require every country in the world to have the capacities to rapidly detect, surveil, and respond quickly to potential public health emergencies of international concern. We also need to realize that just last September, the United Nations adopted the UN Sustainable Development Goals, which are the goals that replace the Millennium Development Goals. And one of the major targets there is universal health coverage, which includes resilient health systems. The IHR, as Peter said, the International Health Regulations, requires these capacities, but it has a very broad level without benchmarks. It has very little compliance of the 196 states that have that are bound by the requirement to have resilient health systems. Only 56 self-reported that they did. There are very weak benchmarks. The Global Health Security Agenda has better benchmarks, but stands well outside of the international health regulations. There is very little transparency, so that when states make their claims that they do have resilient health systems, there's no transparent a system of accountability to make sure that they do. And so how can we fix this? I mean, it seems to me that we need to focus on compliance. And what the commission stated was that it was simply unacceptable to have a system of completely voluntary self-assessments, that you need to have more standardized, regularized, independent, transparent, and accountable capacities. And so you need a system where you can gain that kind of compliance. One way that you can gain compliance is to be constructive, that is to let countries know that we're not here simply to give you a pass or fail. We're here to actually work constructively with you, find financing pathways to make it happen, possible, and then to make sure that you have these sustainable systems, with the major responsibility being on the country itself to invest the funding, but for lower income countries, at least at a temporary level, to have the kind of capacity gaps filled by international financing. This international financing capacity gaps should be filled both by WHO core assessment increases. The commission suggested an increase of 5% of those core capacities, those core assessments of the World Health Organization. But also there are many multilateral financiers. Jim Kim at the World Bank, who Victor talked about, has been very active with a pandemic emergency facility, trying to find ways to make sure that countries are getting the financing they need. But the World Bank and others can actually make financing contingent upon rigorous external assessments. At the international level, we're looking for an international system that's multi-sectoral, that includes health, trade, animal, and human health, and this one health approach. It also is coordinated. It has leadership. It has transparency. It has funding, and it is accountable. The WHO Constitution says that it ought to be the leading and coordinating organization for global health in the world, but the Ebola epidemic demonstrated that the capacities for that simply weren't there. The commission, as Peter talked about, proposed a center for health emergency preparedness with a technical governing board that would be independent, rigorous, transparent, and would hold the center to account. Interestingly, the center that we proposed is a common theme of all four major global commissions, and the last one was the UN High-Level Panel on Global Health Crises, which also recommended these kinds of centers. The center would oversee the international health regulations. It would have a daily watch list of high risk potential epidemics. Its governance would be transparent, independent, and accountable, and it would be well-funded. Dr. Chan has broadly accepted this idea. The funding is still a major challenge. The independence of the center is also a major challenge, but I think that there has been a meeting of the minds that this has been necessary. One of the things that the commission realized, though, that there will be a point in an epidemic when it spins out of control into a humanitarian disaster. At that stage, you need to have a pivot from the WHO as the routine leader to the wider United Nations system, where the Secretary General, the Security Council, and others would be highly involved. That would raise the political profile to a level that we need. We also need the kind of political will to make the international health regulations work, because if you look at all of the major epidemics, from SARS to MERS to H1N1, you find one thing in common, that countries tend to underprepare in terms of their own ability to respond, but overreact in ways that have unnecessary travel and trade restrictions, which are violations of the international health regulations. So we need to find a way to both empower countries to actually respond in an appropriate way through medicine, public health systems, but not to react in ways that violate human rights and the international health regulations. I promised that I was going to end with the idea of why global health needs to be in the realm of high politics. And I've talked about the UN system and the Secretary General. Victor mentioned that the G7 agenda had planned and still plans to look at the Global Health Risk Framework Commission report and the UN report and other global health security aspects, including antimicrobial resistance. But I've always been worried that Ebola opened a political window of opportunity, but that political window of opportunity is an urgent one and it's rapidly closing. And if you think about the other things that are crowding out the global agenda, including the European migration crisis, the North Korean nuclear ambitions, including ISIS and the Middle East, there's every reason and potential that political leaders may pivot their attention away from global health security. If that were to occur, it would be such a moral and public health unacceptable event, because if we learned anything from Ebola, and if we now learn anything from Zika, we need to get high-level political attention. And so let's all work hard. I know that the commissioners and the oversight committee will work hard to keep this on the global health agenda, to make sure that security remains first and foremost.
Thank you, Larry. And now to the second half of this afternoon's proceedings. This will be our panel discussion. And for this panel discussion, we have the privilege of having our president, Professor Peter Matteson, to moderate the panel discussion. Now, perhaps just a few words about how we want to go about this. We will first have Professor Matteson inviting comments from the panelists, who will comprise all the speakers that you've heard so far. And following that, he will take questions from the floor. Now, if you wish to ask a question, may I ask you to look for someone with a microphone that will be handed to you? And of course, we're all very interested in knowing who you are, so let us know who you are and perhaps your institution as well. And please keep your question short, one sentence, and if possible, try not to add commentaries. Thank you. So, Professor Matteson.
Thank you. I hope you all noticed that what I just did was I asked the dean for my instructions. That's an insight into the way the University of Hong Kong works. Various people have thanked us or thanked me or thanked the university for hosting us, but actually the honor is all ours. I think it's a tremendous opportunity for us to have such a distinguished group of experts here and to be present at the Asia launch of such an important report. And I don't want to take up too much time because I want to leave as much time as possible for the audience to ask questions. I was reminded when I was listening to the speakers of the quote by George Santayana, which is that those which fail to learn from history are doomed to repeat it. And I think that applies very much to the thinking of this report. I just wanted to, I made myself 3 points I wanted to talk about, and I based this on my own experience of Ebola. So I've spent a lot of time in East Africa, not in West Africa, but in East Africa, teaching and doing a bit of research. And I was in Uganda in 2000 when there was an Ebola outbreak. And the thing that struck me about that outbreak was the importance of social science in its management. And I suppose the first question I wanted to ask the panel, and I'll invite any panelists to comment on any of these 3 points, but the first one, is there enough social science in our understanding of the report, in our understanding of the response to the threat of global infections? Because, for example, with Ebola, the management of the dead is critical to containing the outbreak, and there are practices, certainly in East Africa, in relation to the dead, that were critical in terms of understanding and containing that outbreak. So that's the first point, just the importance of social science. Second point I made was, to myself, was that this topic of preparedness, I absolutely applaud, and I think the point that was made about it costing much more to mop up afterwards than it does if you're properly prepared, I think is a point that, that comes across from the report and I think is really important. But many of the parts of the world that need to be most prepared are those parts of the world which are the least capacity for that preparedness, and that certainly applies to East Africa, certainly applies to Uganda. So how can the developed world help the developing world to be prepared? Because I think that's critical to the future. And then the third point is just about the use of modern technology. I read an article recently about how Google searches can lead to the early identification of epidemics, where by searching on what symptoms people are looking up and checking, you can predict the occurrence of epidemics. I think that's a really interesting topic. So how can we use modern technology, including social media, which was mentioned, but also computer technology, how can we use these things to get ahead rather than playing catch-up, as many of the speakers referred to us doing? So those are my three questions. The importance of social science, how can the developed world help those parts of the world less fortunate than ourselves to be prepared? And thirdly, what use can we make of modern technology? I don't know who wants to. Larry, do you want to go first?
Yeah, well, I can start with the first one. And the commission spent a lot of time on that. We thought that that culture, anthropology, social science were critically important. And I think we saw this so clearly with Ebola, with the burial practices in other areas. But we also saw it with AIDS in the sense that community-level engagement, bottom-up approaches to taking care of communities and to empowering communities made all the difference with AIDS. And I've always thought that AIDS changed the world, and it was particularly because of the civil society and social mobilization behind that. I would just finish by saying that if you think about epidemics, there is one wealth that's more important than anything else, which is public trust. That if you fail to gain the public trust and fail to gain the public cooperation, you will never bring an epidemic under control. And so I think culture, civil society, public trust are absolutely critical. So I'm glad you made that the very, very first question, because I think it's the most important one.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, Victor.
Yeah, I'm sure my colleagues want to expand on that as well. We actually have at least two people who are anthropologists on the commission, which is Paul Farmer and Melissa Parker. And of course, as you know, Paul Farmer is a medical anthropologist. And in fact, when you look at what happened to Ebola, there's a tremendous mistrust, as been pointed out by the community. And also, as you said, there are cultural issues, particularly cultural issues related to the burial rituals, and in which the family wash, clothe, embrace, and of course, get contact in this case. There's a very famous story about a healer, village healer, who in fact, everybody's going to her because they believe in fact that's the way that they can heal from Ebola. And when this healer contracted Ebola and died, about 1,000 villagers came to her burial, and that actually you can track to the dissemination further of the virus. Finally, when you look at what's happening during Ebola, people were staying away from the hospitals because of lack of trust. Mm-hmm. If anything, they were not seeking help. And also, there's a tremendous impact, of course, in vaccination for children, et cetera. So I think all that, I'm glad, as Larry said, you put that critically and important. Community engagement, understanding of culture and trust. And when we begin to think about, maybe later on we'll talk about research and development, clinical trials, you know, when the people who are potentially and can run in clinical trials don't trust, in fact, the health system, then of course you can't conduct the trials on vaccine or drugs, et cetera. So it's a huge issue that I think has not received enough attention in the past and will now, from now on, receive a lot more attention.
Good.
Can I just add a couple of points? On this issue of is there enough social science, you can hear the answer was no. We shouldn't just think it's about traditional societies, because this links to the whole issue of trust and the role of social media in modern societies as well. And I think one of the critical ingredients of an effective response strategy is a kind of communication strategy which is much faster and much more interactive than public health agencies are typically accustomed to deploying. On preparedness, how can the developed world help the countries who want to do the right thing but don't have the resources? Well, for one thing, the rich world is going to have to write some checks. And the reality is that too much of international development assistance doesn't go to the people who need it most, the poorest and the need. And so we need to think hard and make some tough choices about allocation. And we also need to be tough on the countries that can afford to improve their public health systems, but have simply chosen not to prioritize. And so there is going to have to be some quite tough discussion.
And who's going to lead that, and who's going to mandate it?
Well, I think it's not going to happen in a single venue. I was at this World Bank WHO meeting where that discussion was emerging on financing for preparedness, but I think it'll also happen through vehicles like the G7 and the broader UN system. But it's going to be a process rather than a single discussion. And then just finally on technology, look, there are lots of opportunities to use technology, whether it's cheap diagnostic tools that are sort of resilient and don't need to be used in a pristine environment, whether it's indirect surveillance systems like Google, or even better, data aggregation systems. But I also think we shouldn't forget that one thing in my sort of short experience of this I've learned is that a lot of public health is about people. It's about trained nurses. It's about field epidemiologists. And this is one reason that this isn't going to be a quick fix, because even if you gave a lot of these countries the money, there simply aren't the people in these countries, and there needs to be a sustained program of training and development. And there are some very good initiatives out there already, but that needs to be really sustained to build that human capital.
Yeah. Okay. Gabriel.
If I may just address very quickly Peter's three questions. So about weaker players, low, middle-income countries, weak states, frail states, I've learned a lot from a particular concept from the food safety enterprise. And I learned it when I was in government from our current director of health, who was then in charge of food safety for Hong Kong. And of course, I see our permanent secretary for food sitting here in the audience. In the food safety industry, there is such a thing called HACCP, or Hazard Analysis and Critical Control Points. Essentially, all it means is we are as safe as the weakest link in the food supply chain. And I think it really applies here as well. So while there is a very strong moral argument for helping weaker players, countries, member states, it's actually one of self-interest for, as Peter put it, the rich countries are going to have to write a few checks here to make it work. It's out of self-interest because None of us are immune. Yes, it is a cliche that infectious agents respect no national borders, but it is an important cliche, and that is precisely why the rich countries should be writing a few checks towards what Peter Sands told you earlier on about the annual $4.5 billion investment that this report calls for. And I think that it is so classical when we see these bugs, whether it's SARS, as Chor Chuan showed you in his lovely slide about Hong Kong, that particular hotel on the other side of the harbor, spreading it and exporting it to a dozen countries, including Singapore, or whether you're talking about Zika virus, nobody's immune. So the critical point is we have to recognize that it's not just magnanimity, it's not just being a good humanitarian or a good global player, but actually is out of self-interest. On tech enablement, our president is absolutely correct. Yes, social media has opened up new possibilities. And I think that the investment should really be not only in harnessing big data, but perhaps even more importantly, in deep analytics. So while there is a lot that we can learn from people's search patterns, and Google has explored that. So Google, not .com, but Google.org actually has a special arm on health. But that particular special arm also was proven embarrassingly incorrect in terms of Google flu trends, how wrong they were just barely a couple of years ago. So I think the investment in deep analytics, in how that we analyze such big data, and we're not just restricted to the web, to social media. Think of, in London's case, the O2 card, or in Hong Kong's case, the Octopus card. That gives you essentially the mixing pattern that infectious disease epidemiologists and modelers all just assume away in models. We actually know for every single person how they actually mix and where they go. And there's been some really innovative work coming out from Africa, done by people at the Harvard School of Public Health, in terms of using mobile phone data and tracking human movement. Of course, Africa, being a newly emerging, economically speaking, continent, has leapfrogged the rest of us. They went from no phones to having smartphones. And this has really enabled really clever deep analytics to work out how people really interact and how people move, and therefore how bugs move with them. And how infectious epidemics spread. So I think the possibilities are limitless, but we do need to have that annualized $4.5 billion investment to prevent the annualized $60 billion cost that we are now collectively paying.
I'm going to come to Chor Chuan, and then Victor wants to make another comment, and then we're going to open it up to the audience. So Chor Chuan.
Well, it's reflected on the issue of trust in Singapore. I think we had three major things that came out. One is that the best time to build trust is in peacetime. It's not during a crisis. And what this means, of course, is the way in which we set up a preparedness framework. It's very easy to be able to count hospital beds, train nurses, and so on. It's much harder to understand the way in which you implement the preparedness in a way that does not disempower communities, but in fact engages them and creates a certain element of trust between health professionals, health authorities, other players in this in the system, and the general public. And so as we, say, for example, create the benchmarks, the checklists of what preparedness constitutes, I think there's an important role for us to also consider some of these other issues, which are much harder to ascertain. The second part of it is there's another level of trust, and that is actually trust between health systems. During the different outbreaks, we relied on other types of networks of trust between policymakers, between researchers, between healthcare professionals. We were able, for example, to call up our colleagues in Hong Kong and be able to exchange information, which helped us to plan ahead. And I think there's a big role for this in building trust amongst people who are going to be active in outbreak prevention and response. And a key instrument for that, I think, is the training that universities, hospitals, and public health institutions do that effectively create those networks, which are not just for exchange of professional information, but in a sense creates a trusted network that spans different parts of the world. The final thing, which is very difficult, but I think will be increasingly important, is that as we do more research, we come to what we think is the evidence-based, fact-based, the evidence-based of facts. But this is quite often different from what people believe. And it's really also important for us to understand what are some of the key determinants, the key drivers of beliefs and the propagation. Because I think, as Peter and others have mentioned, it's really very critical for us to be able to also bring out messages which we think are based on evidence so as to be able to help move the way people believed and how they act on belief in directions which would favour outbreak control. And this is a very difficult area. It's very cross-cultural, but I think it's going to be an area of increasing importance and focus for the future.
Okay, thank you very much. So Victor's, in the interest of time, going to save his comments till later. So we've got about 15 minutes or so for questions. If you want to ask a question, please wait for the microphone. Please direct your question to a particular panel member. Keep the question short, and I'll encourage my panel colleagues to keep the answers short as well. So, Constance, I think maybe you're the first hand up.
I'm Constance Chen, Director of Health of Hong Kong. First, may I thank the organizer for bringing the meeting to Hong Kong and share with us the very important findings, recommendations of the commission. My question is, we all now know that a lot of novel infections, in fact, a very high proportion, are actually zoonotic in nature, that is, originate from animals. Would the commission share with us in your discussion, did you engage the animal health community in a discussion in drawing the framework, and would the future funding be applicable to investment in the veterinary public health sector?
Who wants to take that question? Peter?
Short answer is yes. As you say, a lot of the emerging disease threats are zoonotic in nature. And there does tend to be quite a sort of siloed approach between people who deal with animal health and people who deal with human health. And that is a vulnerability. And we need to get a lot more communication. And in some countries, it works better than in others. But we need to get a lot more communication across the lines. And indeed, we saw that an essential part of the core capabilities of a national public health system should be effective communication between the veterinary health people. There's also, in the arena of the research agenda, of looking at those sort of early stage animal-to-human transmission mechanisms and so on, as to whether or not we're picking things up early enough. So those were sort of two avenues in which we were particularly interested. But Gabriel, you may want to...
Yeah, the only thing that I would really wish to add is Hong Kong provides a very good example of how the two sectors work together, because it's under the same ministry. It's under the same minister.
Which is unusual.
Which is very unusual. In the UK, of course, is under two different ministries, yeah. As is in the case of mainland China, and of course in the US as well. So how you get the two sectors to really talk to each other is very important. And my last comment is, yes, emerging infectious diseases, zoonosis is very important, but I dare say another huge topic that requires the two sectors to work together is antimicrobial resistance, AMR. And this is really something that is very long overdue and very urgent.
Agreed, yeah. Malik.
Thank you. So this question also is...
Malik, introduce yourself. I know who you are, but introduce yourself.
Malik Pierce from the School of Public Health, the University of Hong Kong. Peter, again, apologies addressing this question to you. So we talked about the resources that are required to raise preparedness to deal with pandemics. And I presume you were talking about national mobilization from national governments. What about the role of the business sector? Because these epidemics do hugely impact the business sector. I mean, SARS in Hong Kong lost a lot to business. I'm sure in West Africa, Ebola did. So is there a way to mobilize the business sector in resourcing this?
I think the business sector can play a role in a number of different ways. There is potentially a role for dedicated hypothecated taxes. We talked about things like you could envisage taxes on trade and tourism and travel, or on the meat and poultry industry. So you could have hypothecated taxes. On the other hand, what we are talking about in public health is fundamentally a public good. And so it's difficult to see individual commercial objectives for businesses to being realized through sort of investment in these arenas. But one thing I think the business community can be helpful on is actually supporting governments in mobilizing the resources and devoting the resources to these arenas. Then there's a second area I think that the business community can be extremely helpful on, which is when a crisis happens. Because businesses have a set of resources and capabilities that can be extremely helpful when you've got a fast-moving outbreak. However, those resources need to be aligned and the communication channels need to be set up before the outbreak happens. One of the things that happened in Ebola and Standard Chartered was the only international bank in the region, was that a lot of the businesses were trying to be helpful but struggling to work out who to talk to and how to coordinate with each other. What one needs to do as a core part of preparedness is work out which businesses have assets and capabilities that could be useful, work out how you're going to communicate with them and literally who you're going to be picking up the phone to, and if possible, practice, do rehearsals. Certainly in the City of London, we have done rehearsals of this sort of thing. So I think businesses can be helpful in a number of different ways. I do think that core funding for basic public health capabilities is likely to be out of general taxation in most cases, simply because it is a fundamental public good intrinsically in its nature.
Victor?
Actually, there's a lot of conversations going on and initiatives in the business sector, particularly through the World Economic Forum. I participated in a report looking at this issue. First of all, there are businesses that's relevant, as Peter said, to this whole supply chain, R&D, etc. But also, if you look at every business, they have in-country operations. So the idea is to create in-country operation preparedness themselves, sharing information and share preparedness. After all, you know, it's going to affect their employees, their business, et cetera. But on a high level, there's the idea that, in fact, certain sectors of business can play a more prominent role globally, creating some kind of a, shall we say, coalition, if you will, such as communications, IT, things like that, that would be extremely important in their contribution besides money. The World Food Program actually has initiated an initiative with the business sector, look particularly at emergency supply chain. So that, all that being said, there's in fact a number of initiatives going on right now, including R&D, vaccine, which public-private partnership being brought together. So I guess the short answer is that business sector can play many roles because of their competencies, because of their interest, creating a public-private partnership.
Okay, good. Yes.
Yes. Can I stand here?
Yeah.
Yeah. My name is Wing Hong Sido, and I suppose I need to introduce myself to say that until I retired recently, I've been running the infection control program in Queen Mary Hospital for over 35 years. After being trained, also partly at the CDC. Now my question is this. Also, by the way, when we had SARS in Hong Kong, our hospital almost had no secondary case. Really exceptional in Hong Kong. I'm sure Gabriel would verify that. Now, my question is this. We now know that for many of these infectious diseases, all you need is quite simple measures. not complicated, you know what I mean? Good hand hygiene, simple masks and so on, you see? And plus, the moment you provide resources, we also know they tend to overdo. In fact, some of them mentioned here, suits, they tend to be counterproductive. N95, if it's not airborne, it's counterproductive. All right, now, I have two short questions. Number one is, I really appreciate this. This is great, you know what I mean? So can I just give my affirmation? But how can you assure, with all these high-level leaders, that you don't neglect those simple measures? You see, and by the way, you don't learn those simple measures by sitting in boards. You need to hands-on do it for 35 years.
Okay, your second question?
Yeah, second question is, the same question is, you see, sometimes when recommendation comes from high level, then when you read the grassroots person have no more real authority to implement it. Now, in Hong Kong, in our hospital, fortunately, I was old enough so that Dr. Yok Chow gave me full freedom, but not in the other hospitals. So these are my two questions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Chul Chuan, maybe you take the first one.
Sure, I think these are very good points. I think the health facilities, as you rightly point out, need to own this as part of their core capabilities. It has got to be a fundamental part of patient safety and something that we all work on. And the exact tools, how we do it, I think guidelines can be promulgated so that we make sure we have the correct calibration. But at the policy level, I think it is true that we need to calibrate what we've learned from certain epidemics like SARS with, you know, which has produced a certain mindset and a certain set of protocols, that we need to calibrate this to other types of infections which to which some of these measures are not applicable. For example, temperature screening at airports, quarantining people, isolating contacts, do not work, we all know, for certain things like flu and so on. So we need to calibrate these things. And for that, I think it has to occur at a policy level so that we, in a sense, develop a more nuanced sequence of outbreak responses than just the standard SOP that would be used for everything.
Good. Darren?
Yeah, I wanted to deal with the idea of simple measures. It's actually exactly right. And, you know, that's one of the reasons why just writing a check isn't enough. You have to write the check for the right things. And if you actually look at how the global health assistance has worked historically, it's exactly opposite of those simple measures. But what are those simple measures? I mean, I wouldn't jump to high technologies. I would start with Zika vector control, hygiene, sanitation, clean water, safe food. So if you really wanted to make a very, very big difference in the health of a population from infectious diseases, but even beyond, you would start with that basic infrastructure. I've called them basic survival needs. And that, I think, is, you know, a critically important message. I'm glad simple public health prevention is the best way to go, at least at the start.
Okay. Anybody else want to comment on? Dealt with? Yep. Okay, good. Yes.
It's Robert Peckham from the Center for the Humanities of Medicine. And I would add, we also need historians. And I was very, very pleased that in virtually all of your talks, history was a very important. I'm a historian of medicine. I had a question, which is whether the argument about sort of economic impact of an epidemic is in danger of eclipsing the moral argument, and how do you calibrate the argument about economic impact with the moral argument?
Larry, I think you're probably best placed to answer that.
Well, I actually don't think that they're contradictory. I think that you need that the economic argument and the moral argument go to the question of how you capture the attention of political leaders, because ultimately, if you're wanting to get the financing, the right kind of financing to do the things that we want to do, you do need to make the moral case. I just gave testimony to Congress on Zika, and I really stress the moral dimension to it, because politically, if 8 months from now, There were babies being brought that were deformities from Zika, and with mothers giving testimony to the baby with their babies. That would be very powerful. But economics are critically important, as Peter said. You do want to capture the attention of finance ministers, of chancellors of the exchequer. And so I don't think they're contradictory. I think that they're synergistic.
Can I just add a point on the, if you blind tested infectious disease outbreaks as a category of threat against other categories of threat, be it terrorism or financial crises or earthquakes or something, you would find it quite shocking how little we spend on infectious disease crisis, because through human history, they have been one of the principal causes of total collapse of societies. And the thing that was remarkable to me is actually, frankly, how poorly the economic argument has been made. We need to articulate the economic argument, not in combat with the moral argument, but actually reinforcing it, because actually having the cumulative GDP loss of these West African countries is double digit. And their recovery rate is slow. Now, actually, that economic loss is not, that has a human cost. That actually costs lives and causes misery. And so I do think that the economic argument doesn't have to be at the expense of the moral one at all.
I might just make the cynical point that does anyone care about the economic impact on West African, poor West African countries? I think if it's when it has an economic impact on the US and on the developed world, then maybe those governments will take more notice. But there was a question,
Larry Summers gave the keynote to our launch in New York, and he was so powerful, in my opinion, and how he framed it. If you take the Spanish flu, and today's terms, it would be $1 trillion. And if you look at the numbers that Peter put forth together, and if you have one of these massive pandemics, it's about 3 to 4% of global GDP. So I think all we're trying to do is to get the attention of global leaders. Otherwise, they look at health as from crisis to crisis, epidemic, pandemics to pandemics. Now you forget and you move on to the next one. So I think that's the main reason why we're putting this.
Hmm. Dr. Christopher Hui, respiratory and critical care medicine at our very own faculty of medicine. My question is directed to Commission Chair Mr. Peter Sands. Thank you for a wonderful presentation and a galvanizing report. I'm going to drill down a little bit on this question of resources again. I apologize, my son was born this week, and so my mind is turned towards global population and the growth of the human population. Now, $4.5 billion goes a long way for 7.4 billion people. It's about 60 cents per head. But by 2020, we're faced with a population by most estimates of 11 billion. Now, that represents a 50% reduction immediately before we've started, because we're then talking about 40 cents per head in terms of investment. Has the Commission taken this into account, and where do we go from here? Thank you.
It's a very good point, and you'd have heard in my remarks the suggestion that $4.5 billion was probably a floor rather than a ceiling. I think we'll try and get the $4.5 billion first, and then once we've got that, we will. But you're absolutely right. An increasing population, also increasing expectations of health, because I don't think $4.5 billion. It doesn't buy you UHC or anything. It buys you the absolute basics that mean that you don't have very obvious gaps in our defense systems. So it's going to have to be a larger number of time over time. But let's put this in perspective. One component part of the Basel III arrangements for protecting the world against financial crises, which is a proposal called TLAC, Total Loss Absorbing Capital. The official estimates of the cost of that are around $17 billion a year.
and that covers the top 28 banks in the world. That's just one bit of an array of things we're doing to prevent financial crises. So it's clear that in some arenas, and I would say the fight against terrorism is another example, we are prepared to put very serious amounts of money to protect against risks. We need to put serious amounts of money against this risk, and it probably is more than $4.5 billion.
Okay, I think I'm going to just let Roberta probably have the last question, but in the interest of time, I will stop there. But all the speakers are going to go to the reception, and so there'll be an opportunity to ask them questions up there. Roberto.
Thank you. Roberto Bruzzone of the Hong Kong U Pasteur Research Poll. So any report has a half-life. So when do you think is the deadline for this report to kick in? And what is the plan B if that doesn't happen in your forecast time?
Victor, you take that little.
Well, when we did this commission, we did a lightning speed for us, because most of our studies take over a year with deep analysis. We did it in 6 months. Thank you for Peter's leadership. I think our half-life, shall we say, we're still really very much in the sweet spot right now, and that some of it may be a tail end that we need to keep working on. And let me explain to you why. First of all, I think that if you look at how these decisions are being made, there's no question that the high-income countries are going to be a big driver of this, and hence G7, which is why we're very focused on G7. And it will be on the agenda. From last year's Merkel's agenda for antimicrobial resistance to neglected disease to Ebola, this is going to be one of the top agenda in health for G7. So that's going to go a long way. We also recognize, because the finance ministers are critically important, so Peter and I are working towards the World Bank IMF meeting. And thirdly, it would be the UN, particularly the UN countries in General Assembly, whatever. So this is all happening as we speak. The tail end. Well, when you think about how what's been said earlier, the investment has to go country by country, particularly the poorer countries, that's going to take some time. And we need to make sure that message keep going out. And so we're taking it to Africa and other places whereby the heads of state is going to hear this is in the best interest of their country to invest, not just in health, but the security aspect. And that's, I think, will take some time. If you ask Margaret Chan, which she's faced with, is the member states, particularly in not the G7 countries, but others who are slow to respond to these issues. When there was a 5% request for supporting the emergency fund, they voted no. So I think this is going to be an issue we have to work on to get many of these people to see, that to buy in the importance. And that, I believe, is the tail end of the timeline. That's going to take a year or more.
I hope they're listening. Okay, please join me in thanking our panelists for a fantastic session.
Thank you, Professor Mathieson. Well, this is not quite the end of the proceedings. Can I ask you to just hang on to your seats for the moment? And may I invite all the panelists and the president to resume their seats? We are going to have a presentation of souvenirs ceremony and photo taking. And in the meantime, I think it would be remiss for me not to offer you a commercial break. On behalf of Professor Hall, Dean of Law over there, Professor Hall, right? Welcome to the Faculty of Law. This is our biggest venue. And in your program, you ought to have flyers for Professor Gostin's book, Global Health Law. Now, this is a book which was published by Harvard University Press in 2014, and translations of it are also available now in the simplified script. So you can see that the Qing Kao Wai Sang part is already available in simplified, and in traditional script, it will also be available a little later this year. Separately, the Center for Medical Ethics and Law at the University of Hong Kong is holding a precision conference on the legal and ethical challenges of precision medicine. You also ought to have a flyer in your folder. If not, we will be happy to give you one or any number that you choose to have outside on the table. Now, this is our first co-organized conference with the Cambridge University's Center for Law, Medicine, and the Life Sciences. So please do take a look at it. And if you're interested, we would be very happy if you sign up. Now, to proceedings, if I may invite President Peter Madison up here on stage to present souvenirs to our overseas speakers on behalf of the organizing units. And in strictly alphabetical order, Professor Zhao. And next, we have Professor Gustin. Thank you, Professor Gustin. Mr. Peter Sands. Thank you, Mr. Sands. Professor Tan Cho Chuan. Thank you, Professor Tan. And now, may I, if I can ask the president to stay on the stage and Professor Tan to stay on the stage, may I invite Dr. Donald Lee of the Bauhinia Foundation Research Center, the Dean of Law, Professor Michael Hall, the Dean of Medicine, Professor Gabriel Leong, to join our president and all our invited speakers on the stage for a group photo.
And of course, our sponsor for the commission work, our local sponsor, Mr. Lau Ming Wai, who's
thank you, ladies and gentlemen. This is the end of today's program. We really thank you for participating in today's seminar. Now, may I invite everyone to join us all on the first floor foyer, that's one floor down of this building, for a tea reception. And you can like chase down your favorite speaker and ask all the questions that you want to ask. Thank you all. Good night.